Good evening. Let me encourage you to find your seats and make yourselves comfortable for a wonderful evening of conversation, dialogue, and thought-provoking conversation. It's my privilege to welcome you here this evening. My name is Tom McCall. I'm the director of the Carl F. H. Henry Center for Theological Understanding, which is co-sponsoring this evening's event along with Chosen People Ministries. And it's my privilege to welcome you here this evening, and it's my privilege to turn this to tonight's moderator, Professor John Feinberg. Dr. Feinberg teaches biblical and systematic theology here at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School, where he served for 33 years. I'll turn this to him in just a moment, but first, let's make sure that we do what we should do, and that's welcome the Holy Spirit here with prayer together. So let us pray. God of grace and glory, we give you thanks for this opportunity we have. Lord, we do not take this privilege lightly, but we are indeed grateful, and we ask that we are good stewards of this time and of this opportunity. Lord, we pray that you will give us clarity of thought and charity of heart as we reflect on these deep mysteries this evening. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Join me in welcoming Dr. Feinberg.
Thank you so much, Dr. McCall, and a very, very hearty and special welcome to each of you. We are so thankful that you have joined us this evening, and I think you are in for a very, very special treat. We are very pleased to be co-hosting this between the Henry Center and Chosen People Ministries. And we have, I think, a very, very interesting and important topic for our time together this evening. It is entitled, Whatever Happened to Israel's Promised Kingdom? Now, in just a moment, I want to give a description that was given to each of our presenters, and they have then framed and formed what they were going to say this evening. But before I get to that, I just want to give you a basic idea of how we're going to proceed this evening. After I have shared the topic for the evening, we are then going to have each of our presenters come and give a 20-minute presentation on the topic of the evening. And then once that has finished, we're going to take a very, very short break, maybe a minute or two just to let you stretch. And then we're going to come back and we'll have a time of interaction between the three presenters that we have this evening. And then once that part of the evening is finished, we are going to open up a time for those of you in the audience to give us questions. Although there's something that we've already done in advance of that, you probably will notice that on your seats or close by, there's a card. These are there for you to write any questions that you would like to address to the speakers, and feel free to address the questions to all of them, or only to one or two of them. And so we'll have a time of question and answer, and then we'll close off the evening with a time of prayer. We want to thank very much the Henry Center for its involvement, its sponsoring of this, and also Chosen People Ministries. A special word of thanks to my dear friend and colleague, Dr. Tom McCall, who's the director of the center, for all he has done. And a very special word of thanks to Jeff Fulkerson and the staff at the center. They have been fantastic in handling so many details involved in this evening program. We could not have done this without them. We couldn't have done it without staff at Chosen People Ministries as well. And so we're so thankful to everyone who has made this evening possible. Well, we need to move on to the topic of the evening. And as you know, the title is Whatever Happened to Israel's Promised Kingdom? And I'm going to read to you the statement that was given to each of our presenters, and then we will introduce our first presenter and go from there. During the Old Testament era, God made various covenants with Abraham and his descendants. The promises contained in those covenants and the prophecies that grew out of them led the people of Israel to believe that God would establish a kingdom for her and greatly bless her. Kingdom blessings would include a right spiritual relation between God and Israel, but the blessings would also be material. The Jews understood the blessings to include the promise of land, in particular, the land of Israel. Did Israel misunderstand what God covenanted and prophesied that he would do? If so, what did God actually promise Israel? If not, whatever happened to Israel's kingdom? Was it fulfilled or forfeited, or is it still future? Our trialogue this evening will discuss the broad issue of promises of a kingdom for Israel. In particular, we're asking and have asked each of the presenters to address the following. First of all, what kind of kingdom, if any, did God ever promise Israel? And if he did promise a kingdom to Israel, did it include the land of Israel as her possession? Were those promises made to all ethnic Jews or only to regenerate ones? If God didn't promise Israel a kingdom, how do you interpret biblical texts that many think say otherwise? Now, I know that's more than one question, but that's one question area. Second question area, if Israel was promised a kingdom, whatever happened to it? Was it A, fulfilled, for example, during the reigns of David and Solomon? B, forfeited because of rejecting her Messiah? Or is it still future? That would be option C. Or should we offer a different response entirely? And then a third area that we're asking our presenters to address. Some evangelical Christians believe that God did promise the land of Israel to the Jews. And hence they think that believers should support the state of Israel's efforts to hold the land she now possesses. In light of your answers to the first two question areas, what do you think? Well, this promises to be a very, very interesting and lively discussion. I would like now to introduce our first presenter, and it is Dr. Richard Pratt, Jr. He is the president of Third Millennium Ministries. And for many, many years, Dr. Pratt has been involved in higher theological education. In fact, for many, many years, he chaired the Old Testament department and taught at Reformed Theological Seminary in Jackson, Mississippi, and Orlando, Florida. In fact, all of that for some 21 years. Dr. Pratt received a BA from Roanoke College, an MDiv from Union Theological Seminary, and the THD from Harvard University. He has traveled extensively throughout the world to evangelize and lecture, and frankly, it's easier to tell you where he hasn't been than where he has. He's been all over the world serving the Lord, and it's a delight to have him here with us this evening. Dr. Pratt has also been quite involved in publication work. He has served as the general editor for the NIV Spirit of the Reformation Study Bible. He has also been a translator for the New Living Translation and a Christian theology consultant for the Islamic Encyclopedia. In addition, and I think many of you will find this interesting, as the other things are interesting, but interesting in a slightly different way, Dr. Pratt was a consultant for Steven Spielberg's Prince of Egypt. So I don't know whether he's up for an Oscar nomination here, but he should be. Dr. Pratt's books include Every Thought Captive and also Pray with Your Eyes Opened and the book Design for Dignity, and also he gave us stories. as well as two commentaries, one of them on 1st and 2nd Chronicles, and the other on 1st and 2nd Corinthians. His books have been translated into several languages, including Chinese, Mandarin, Russian, and Spanish. And he's also a contributor to the Complete Literary Guide to the Bible, and he has authored a number of journal articles as well. Now, as we said at the outset, he is the president of Third Millennium Ministries, and this is an organization that is committed to training Christian leaders around the world that are needed to train people in their own lands. This ministry was launched in 1997 to create various multimedia curriculum for Christian leaders everywhere. And as to its aim, it intends to provide biblical education for the world for free. Creating a multimedia seminary curriculum in the core languages of English and Arabic and Mandarin Chinese, Russian, and Spanish, Third Millennium designs and records high-quality video lessons in-house that are similar to the style of what one might see on the History Channel. Well, Third Millennium is a ministry that is not only dedicated to creating a sound biblical curriculum, but is also equally committed to distributing it globally. And they have various means of doing that, DVDs, the web, mobile apps, and so many other ways. They are partners with 193 of the countries that are recognized by the United Nations. And as a result of that, through God's grace and enablement, they are saturating the globe with multimedia master's level education for Christian leaders. So it is a real privilege and treat for us to have Dr. Pratt with us this evening. Dr. Pratt, come now and give us your presentation. He will be presenting an all-millennial, or as some would prefer it, a realized millennial position on the issues before us tonight. Welcome with me, Dr. Pratt.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. How are you tonight? I hope you're okay. It's going to snow tomorrow, you know. Are you ready for this? I'm from Orlando. I'm not ready for it. I'm getting out of here as fast as I can. It's a delight to be with you tonight, and we're going to be struggling through using the PowerPoint, and if I mess up, we'll just go back and do this very informally. But let me say that the last time I gave a public talk on this topic or related topic was in Egypt, the year before the Arab Spring in Alexandria, and I was asked to come speak at a conference that was advertised on radio and television, and the topic that they gave me was this. Are you ready? Does Israel have a right to the land of Palestine? So I was with a mixed group of Christians and Muslims, and it was a very interesting night. At the end, I got an Allahu Akbar, and I don't expect that tonight. But I may get something else. I don't know from whom, but I may get some reaction like that. It was a fascinating time, but tonight will be a little bit different. We are on a very strict timetable, and so I have before me for the next 20 minutes 4 points that I need to lay out, and I'll do this just as well as I possibly can, and as systematically as I can, 4 propositions, and the first of which is this. The land promised to Abraham was the geographical starting point for the worldwide expansion of God's kingdom through Israel. That's a little different than what many people think when they think about Israel's kingdom, especially as it relates to the land of Israel, to the land of Palestine. Let's make the point first that this idea of Israel or the promised land being a geographical starting point reflects the fact that the promise to Abraham for the land of promise was, in fact, rooted in or set upon the foundations, the kingdom foundations of the primeval history. And all of us know that in the beginning, when God first made humanity, he made them in his image and in his likeness, and he told them, I want you to serve me here within the Garden of Eden, but that's not enough for me, because my kingdom is to spread to the ends of the earth, and that was to be done by means of the royal and priestly figures, Adam and Eve, the image and the likeness of God. That is the background of what Abraham did, because in his day, he was actually given that mantle, that task. He took it up as a special kingdom builder in his day. In addition to that, of course, after sin came into the world, this kingdom building that Adam and Eve were to do as the image and likeness of God involved conflict. Conflict between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. And in my opinion, likely to be an allusion to the power of Egypt represented by the serpent. The evil one, whose power was in opposition to the image and the likeness of God redeemed in the days of Adam and Eve. So Genesis 3:15 tells us that, yes, this global kingdom of God was coming. This is the beginning point, but it would only come through great conflict. And of course, it's reiterated in chapter 9, verse 1, in the days of Noah, when they come out of the ark, and they're told to be fruitful and multiply once again. This foundation of the kingdom of Israel in the primeval history of Genesis then finds its development within Israel itself. As you know, Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3, the call of Abraham, where God says to Abraham in verse 3, I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. In this process on which God placed Abraham, it was not simply to be a time of blessing for him, receiving a land and then living in that land, the so-called promised land, but rather Abraham was actually to be engaged with other peoples. And the language of conflict that's here in verse 3 of chapter 12 also illustrates for us the continuation of Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who treat you with contempt. Maybe a way to translate that. So in Abraham's life and those that followed him in his race, the conflict was a part of the kingdom building. And of course, we know that this is also the case in passages like Genesis chapter 17, where God says to Abraham in covenant that nations will come from him, that kings will come from him. And also Genesis chapter 49, verse 10 tells us that, in fact, the scepter of God is going to be handed to the tribe of Judah, and that Judah will be the one who reigns over the people of God until the peoples, the nations, are submitted to him, are put under his dominion. So once again, we see that Israel's concept of having a place to live, a homeland, a promised land, was not simply that they would own this particular piece of real estate, but that this was the starting point. It was, as it were, Omaha Beach for Israel. That once they took that beachhead of the promised land, that was not the end point. It was simply the beginning point for the kingdom of Israel to grow and to spread throughout the world. Joshua, in fact, did not even receive in his day the extent of the land that was promised to Abraham in Genesis chapter 15. But rather, God said, you're only to do this particular much of it. It was only until the days of David that the borders of the promised land were expanded to the place where God had promised Abraham in Genesis 15. And David went beyond that, as did Solomon, the wise man who actually made Israel the center of world economy in his day when he made it possible to avoid transferring goods from the east to the west by means of caravans, because he actually took Ezion-Geber, hired the Phoenician navy, and was able to become then the centerpiece of the world, so that silver was as plentiful as sycamore trees in the land of Israel, the city of Jerusalem. And of course, we all know that Psalm 72 reflects the hope, the dream, that the king who reigns on the throne of Israel will not simply rule over Israel, but will rule over the entire world. And so it's no wonder then that the Apostle Paul, looking at this kind of data in the Old Testament, would say in Romans chapter 4, verse 13, that the promise to Abraham and his offspring that he would be heir of the world. So when you think of the kingdom of Israel, it is not simply a kingdom in the promised land. It is a kingdom that was designed and purposed by God to rule over the entire world, proposition number one. The land promised to Abraham was the geographical starting point for the worldwide expansion of God's kingdom through Israel. Number two, the prophets predicted the worldwide expansion of God's kingdom through Israel in conjunction with the end of their exile. As you already know, I'm sure, God threatened Israel with temporary judgment the temporary judgment, that would the greatest of which was exile from the land, destruction at the hands of Gentiles, and then exile from the land. You can see the root of this in Abraham's own covenant in Genesis chapter 17, when God says to Abraham, "Abraham, walk before me and be blameless, and I'll confirm my covenant with you." And in verses 9 through 14, when he institutes the rite of circumcision as a sign of the covenant curses that would come upon him. Leviticus chapter 26 says that if you disobey me, then I will punish you, and if you repent, fine, but if you don't, I will multiply your judgment seven times, and seven times, and seven times, and seven times. And the climax of this sevenfold multiplication of the judgment was, of course, as you know, exile. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verses 25 through 31 tells us that exile was threatened against Israel in the days of Moses if they turned to idolatry and forsook the law of God. And as you all know also, I'm sure, Deuteronomy chapters 29 and 30 speak of the covenant curses and then the covenant blessings. The worst curse would be to be sent out, exiled from the land of promise. The greatest blessing that could possibly come after that would be to be returned to a time when you were more prosperous, as he says in Deuteronomy chapter 30, more prosperous and more numerous than ever before. 2 Samuel 7 makes it clear that the promise to David, his covenant, God's dynastic covenant with David, was conditional. That, yes, it would never pass utterly from the house of David as it passed from the dynasty of Saul, but at the same time, individual kings in Israel could suffer and suffer severely the floggings of the nations against them. Psalm 89 does the same thing, the second great passage that deals with David's covenant, and Psalm 132, verse 12, does the very same thing as well. So there was temporary judgment threatened against Israel. Even though they had entered the land, even though they had come to the land, God said, now you must live according to my word, or you will be suffering the curses of covenant. But the wonderful thing that the prophets also said was that if this indeed did happen, and remember in the days of Moses, this was simply a threat. But if indeed in those days, then what you must understand is that the fulfillment of the end of the exile would come. That at this time of the fulfillment at the end of the exile would be a day of great glory. As we read in Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 30, when you are in tribulation or in trouble and all these things that come upon you, in the latter days, the eschatological days, you'll return to the Lord your God and obey his voice. For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not leave you nor destroy you or forget the covenant with your fathers that he swore to them. And of course, we know that Daniel chapter 2, verses 35 through 45 talks about this as one of the many passages that does, but gives you once again the sense of what will happen once the return from exile occurs, what the hope and the dream is. The stone that struck the image, you remember the image with the various empires represented in it, became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. The kingdom of the God of heaven will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed, nor shall the kingdom be left to another people. It shall break in pieces all these kingdoms and bring them to an end, and it shall stand forever. Number three. The fulfillment of these prophetic predictions about the worldwide expansion of God's kingdom through Israel in the last days was affected by intervening historical contingencies. Now we're getting a little more idiosyncratic. When I say intervening historical contingencies, what I mean by that is this, that in the Bible, when prophets make predictions, the events that occur after their predictions can, in God's purposes and in God's wisdom and according to his will, have effects on how prophecies are fulfilled. They are intervening between the prediction and the fulfillment, and they can cause radical adjustments in the ways in which prophecies or predictions are fulfilled. The case in point, of course, is the famous passage in Jeremiah chapter 18, verses 7 through 10. Every system of prophecy that I know of that's been endorsed by evangelicals believes this to be true, the most famous of which Mitch will bring to us when he talks about the 69th year in Daniel, the gap that comes after the 69th week of years. And so this is nothing unusual, but it's often not said that when a prediction is made, the fact is that what happens between the prediction and its fulfillment can have dramatic effects. And the most dramatic effect, because I'm cutting back in time here, the most dramatic effect has to do with the fulfillment of prophecies regarding the eschatological or last days after the exile. And you can find it in Daniel chapter 9, where Daniel is doing his morning devotions, reading the book of Jeremiah. And he finds that Jeremiah said the exile is going to last 70 years. But then Daniel receives word from Gabriel that it's not going to be, this exile is not just going to be 70 years, it's going to be 70 weeks of years. So the 70 weeks are declared about your people and your holy city to finish the transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness. So there is, in fact, a delay that occurs, according to Daniel chapter 9, for the return of Israel to its glorious state, and then its eventual worldwide dominion. And number four, the New Testament explains that the intervening historical contingencies affect how the Messiah fulfills the worldwide expansion of God's kingdom through Israel. If I were to summarize the teaching of the New Testament, it would basically be this. It explains how Messiah actually fulfilled the last day's prophecies, that is, those prophecies given with respect to the end of Israel's exile, and brings the kingdom of God, because it comes in a way that people were not expecting. Why? Because of the intervening historical contingencies that occurred between the times of the prophets and the times of Jesus. So that Jesus, in Acts chapter 1, is asked by the apostles, Lord, as he is about to ascend into heaven, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And the response, of course, is not no, never, impossible, but nor is it, of course, and this is how it's going to happen. No, what Jesus does is what at least three people in the Old Testament did when they heard prophecies, and they said, what's going to happen? And they say in Hebrew, mi yodea, or who knows what's going to happen? Let's see what happens. And in effect, that's what Jesus does here. The Lord will at this time, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. And so we find then that not only do we find Jesus saying, what you must do is wait to see how this worldwide Israeli kingdom is going to unfold. Do you hear that? But we also find that the Apostle Paul in Romans chapters 9 through 11 does the very same thing. That he offers various scenarios by which this worldwide kingdom of Israel, rooted in primeval history, promised to Abraham, predicted by the prophets at the end of the exile, is now actually going to unfold. As regards the gospel, he says in Romans 11, 28 and 29, the Jews are the enemies of God for your sake. But as regards elections, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers, for the gifts and calling of God are irrevocable. It seems to me that any Christian who cannot balance between those two points, that on the one side, according to the gospel, they are the enemies of God if they do not believe in the gospel, and on the other side, they are beloved of God, they are loved of God because of the promises given to the prophets, that tension, that paradox in many respects, is at the heart of the matter. So we must wait to see exactly how God is going to work this out, but it's on the basis of these two things in tension with each other. And of course, we know that at the end, Revelation chapter 11, verse 15, this global vision will come to fruition. The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. But the last word I have for you on this is this. What will be the capital city of this great worldwide empire run and ruled by the King of Israel, the Christ, the Messiah? What will be the capital city? Will it be New York? No. Will it be Washington, D.C.? No. Will it be Paris? No. What will it be? New Jerusalem. So from beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, the vision has been that God, through his vice regents on this earth, will establish his kingdom from one geographical starting point, and they will then expand that geographical starting point to the ends of the earth through conflict, after the fall into sin. That was inherited by Abraham, and the promise was made that he would go to that promised land, his people would inherit it, but from that point forward, they would expand the kingdom of Israel to the ends of the earth. This is why in Deuteronomy chapter 20, verses 10 through 20, Moses gives direction not only for how Israel is to fight within the land of Canaan, but how they are to fight outside the land of Canaan. Extremely important, because from the beginning of the conquest, the goal was not simply to take the promised land, it was to take the world. And the prophets predicted that, yes, if you go into exile, don't worry. In the last days, I'll bring you back, and we will set this program as it should be, with the great Son of David at the helm, leading God's people to the ends of the earth in conflict with evil. And this, of course, is what the New Testament tells us and explains how it unfolds. And so as you and I deal with this matter, it seems to me that in many respects, our approach to this must be, this is nothing more than and nothing less than what God planned from the very beginning, that his image, his servant, his human servant, his human vice regent would expand his kingdom from the center, geographical centerpiece of the world, the Garden of Eden, which is the land of promise, Abraham's land of promise, to the ends of the earth by fighting conflict, by fighting against evil and those that follow evil. And that Jesus explains in the New Testament and his apostles and prophets explain to us how this will unfold. In the beginning of Jesus' work when he first came, now through the kingdom age or the church age today, and at the second coming. And in many respects, even New Testament prophecies of how these things will unfold still await their fulfillment. And as a result, the intervening historical contingencies of human history also have effects on how even New Testament prophecies will be fulfilled.
Thank you so much, Dr. Pratt. Appreciate that. Our next presenter is Dr. Richard Averbeck. He is the professor of Old Testament and Semitic languages at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School, and he is also the director of the PhD program in theological studies. Dr. Averbeck came to know the Lord when he was 18 years old at the University of Wisconsin, River Falls. And about 2 years later, he transferred to Calvary Bible College in Kansas City, where he began academic study of the Bible and theology and biblical languages. In 1974, after his graduation from college, Richard and his wife Melinda were married, and they moved to Grace Theological Seminary in Winona Lake, Indiana. In 1977, he completed the Master of Divinity program at Grace, and then they moved to Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, to pursue the Doctor of Philosophy program in Ancient Near Eastern Studies and Biblical Hebrew at the Dropsie College for Hebrew and Cognate Learning. Now it is known as the Annenberg Research Institute of the University of Pennsylvania. Dr. Averbeck finished his dissertation on the Gudea cylinders, a long Sumerian temple building hymn from about 2100 BC, and he received the PhD in 1987 from Dropsie. Between 1987 and 1989, while continuing to teach full-time in Old Testament studies at Grace, he engaged in the study of biblical counseling under his colleague at Grace, Dr. Lawrence Crabb Jr. And he received the Master of Arts in Biblical Counseling degree in 1989. And in addition to everything else that he does, he is also presently a licensed professional counselor in the state of Wisconsin. Now, from 1990 to 1994, Dr. Averbeck taught full-time at Dallas Seminary in the fields of Old Testament studies and biblical counseling, as well as carrying on a part-time private counseling practice. In 1994, he joined the faculty of Trinity Evangelical Divinity School as a full-time professor in Old Testament and Semitic languages. And then in 2010, he took the directorship of the PhD program in theological studies at Trinity. Now, Dr. Averbeck has a number of publications in the fields of ancient Near Eastern studies, especially, as you would imagine, given his dissertation, especially publications on Sumer and Sumerian literature, the relationship between ancient Near Eastern studies and the Old Testament law, and so on and so forth. He has journal articles and encyclopedia articles in Walter Elwell's Dictionary of Biblical Theology, Willem van Gemeren's New International Dictionary of Old Testament Theology and Exegesis, and David Baker's and T. Desmond's Dictionary of the Old Testament, Pentateuch. Now, in addition to that, he was the main editor and consultant to the work entitled Life and Culture in the Ancient Near East. And he has published on the Gudea Cylinders and Sumerian Creation Texts in a series entitled The Context of Scripture, Volumes 2 and Volumes 4. The latter one is forthcoming. Now, in addition to all of these other things, Dr. Averbeck has in recent years become engaged in the new and renewed, I should say, scholarly discussions about the early chapters of Genesis. And not too long ago, in late September, early October of 2011, he was one of five main speakers at the Bryan Institute Symposium on reading Genesis 1 through 2. Now, his particular chapter that came out of that is entitled A Literary Day, Intertextual and Contextual Reading of Genesis 1 and 2, and that appeared in the book Five Views on Genesis 1 and 2. Well, in addition to all of these things, I think some of you may know that Trinity is sponsoring through the Henry Center a research initiative that has been funded by the Templeton Religious Trust or Religion Trust, and it has to do with Evangelical Theology and the Doctrine of Creation Project. And Dr. Averbeck has been appointed as one of the co-directors of that initiative. Well, he has many other publications, including commentaries on the books of Leviticus and Numbers. So he comes with many, many and varied credentials. It's a great privilege to have him with us this evening. He is going to be presenting a paper that deals with a premillennial, non-dispensational approach to the question of whatever happened to Israel's kingdom. Please welcome with me now Dr. Richard Averbeck.
Thank you, Dr. Feinberg. I didn't realize you were going to go through all that. Okay. So, this is a delight to be here tonight, and I'm thankful for the audience, the live streaming, all that's going on with it. It's a very important topic. And so I look forward to just sharing with you some of the things that I have done in this area in my own thinking with regard to this matter. So, what is a covenant? Basically, a covenant is a solemn formal means of establishing and defining a relationship. There are at least two parties to a covenant, and in one way or another, the issue at hand is always the doing of relationship between them. When the term is used for the relationship between God and people, it is intended as a way to help us understand how the Holy God does relationship with us as fallen, sinful people. We need to understand and keep in mind, however, that covenant is a metaphor. It's a metaphorical language, a figure of speech, an analogy. We know this because the same terminology that is used for God's covenants with us is also used in the Bible to designate a treaty, alliance, grant, loyalty oath, or something of the sort between people. Abraham, for example, made a treaty covenant with Abimelech in Genesis 21. And the terminology for making the treaty there is the same as that used when the Lord made his covenant with Abraham in Genesis 15. The concept comes from that world and has analogs in the surrounding ancient Near Eastern world of that day. Abraham already knew what a covenant was when the Lord used it as a solemn way of establishing and defining his relationship with him. The point of the Noahic covenant is to preserve the natural order of humanity and land animals through the flood and perpetuate it after the flood. It is not focused on Israel in particular, but establishes relative stability in the natural order. It is a creation covenant, so to speak. He had judged the corruption of the world by means of the flood, and then afterwards he committed to never dealing with our corruption in the same way. This brings us to the Abrahamic covenant. God's call and commission of Abram in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, is of course a key passage, even though it is not in the form of a covenant. That comes later in Genesis 15 and 17. The rendering here offered of the Genesis 12 passage takes certain Hebrew grammatical features into consideration. The Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from your country, your people, and your father's household, and go to the land I will show you, in order that I may make you into a great nation, and bless you, make your name great, and be a blessing, in order that I may bless those who bless you, and curse those who curse you, so that all the peoples on earth may be blessed through you." There is a twofold command and purpose sequence in the passage. The Lord says, "Do this in order that I may do this in you." First in verses 1 and 2, and then at the end of verse 2 in verse 3. The whole commission ends with a result, so that all peoples on earth may be blessed through you. The Lord called Abram to trust him and step outside of his own comfort and safety with his family to go to another place. In that place and situation, he would only have the Lord himself to trust and depend on. The result of living by this kind of faith in the Lord would be that Abram himself would become the historical pivot man for all the families and peoples that multiplied and occupied the earth after the flood. The same core principle of faith comes out in anticipation of the first passage in which the Abrahamic relationship with God is put into covenant form. The first section of Genesis 15 is all about the seed of Abram. After all, Sarai was barren, and they had been in the land for a long time by now. Abram was becoming concerned about dying without physical offspring. But the Lord promised him, look up at the sky and count the stars. If indeed you can count them, then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abram's response was to trust the Lord's promise. He believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as righteousness. As is well known, for the Apostle Paul, this verse becomes a primary Old Testament text undergirding his argument in Galatians 3 and Romans 4 that salvation comes through faith, not by circumcision or keeping the Old Testament law. After all, Abram was reckoned as righteous before either circumcision or law had been instituted. The second section of Genesis 15 in verse 7 brings a promise of the land. I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of it. Abram's immediate response was, Sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of it? The Lord does not take this as an unwillingness to believe, but simply a request for an oath guarantee, which he was ready, willing, and able to supply. He instructs Abram to bring some animals, divide them in two, except for the birds, and lay the halves opposite one another with a path between them. I will not go into all the details here, but later in this scene, the Lord himself passed between the parts of the animals in the form of a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch. Verse 17. For the Israelite readers of Moses' day, this would have recalled the glory cloud with the pillar of fire in it by night that led them out of Egypt. As verses 18 through 21 put it, on that day the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, to your descendants I give this land, from the Wadi of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates, the land of the Kenizzites, Kadmonites, and all the other ites. There is a parallel to this procedure in Jeremiah 34, but I cannot go into that here. Suffice it to say that when the Lord passed between the parts of the animals in the form of a smoking fire pot with a blazing torch, he was taking upon himself a self-curse to the effect that if he did not fulfill this covenant, may the birds of prey consume his dead corpse, so to speak. Some react against this interpretation because it sounds sacrilegious to them. But isn't this in reality very much like what the Lord actually did when the Son of God died on the cross for our sins? Our Lord goes to great extremes in his commitment to redeem and restore us to himself. In Genesis 15, this was the Lord's way of solemnly swearing to Abram that his covenant commitment to giving the promised land to his seed was absolute and guaranteed by the Lord himself. The next statement of the Abrahamic covenant comes in Genesis 17. After an introduction, the passage begins with something very similar to Genesis 12. God begins with two imperatives commanding Abram, walk before me faithfully. Let me see, that didn't go quite right, okay? walk before me faithfully and be blameless. And follows with the purpose clauses, in order that I may institute my covenant between you and me, between me and you, and greatly increase your numbers. After Abram fell down on his face, God proclaimed his covenant commitment to Abram. In verses 6 through 7, the Lord promises, I will make you very fruitful. I will make nations of you, and kings will come from you. I will establish my covenant as a permanent covenant between me and you and your descendants after you for the generations to come to be your God and the God of your descendants after you. In the very next verse, God proclaims, the whole land of Canaan, where you now reside as a foreigner, I will give as a permanent possession to you and your descendants after you, and I will be their God. I have rendered Olam permanent here in both verses to try to capture the effect of the passage. The point is that here both the seed promise and the land promise are permanent. Recently, some scholars have been arguing that there are really two Abrahamic covenants. The one in Genesis 15 about the great nation Israel, promised in Genesis 12, verse 2, and the other in Genesis 17, where the focus is on all the peoples of the earth of Genesis 12, 3. According to this view, Genesis 15 was only a preliminary stage in God's unfolding plan of redemption. The second stage is about how Abram, through the great nation, descended from him would mediate blessings to all peoples on the earth, which is the focus of Genesis 17 and 22, according to this view. Moreover, the promises to Israel as a great nation are eventually subsumed under the new covenant in the new creation to come in Revelation 21 and 22. I have no problem with the latter point, but there are some misleading steps on the way to this end. First, when the analysis refers to Genesis 15 as focused on the great nation of Genesis 12, there's a disconnect from the text. Actually, as shown above, the covenant commitment in Genesis 15 is specifically about the land God promised to the seed of Abram. Second, as shown above, the Genesis 17 passage has a land promise just as permanent as the seed promise and its extension to all the peoples of the earth. Nevertheless, one scholar argues, for example, that even though nationhood is not altogether absent in Genesis 17, stress is placed on nations, kings, and perpetual divine human relationship with Abram's offspring. This minimizes the importance of the promise of the land in a way that does not give due attention to the explicit emphasis of the text. Third, the term covenant never appears in Genesis 22. Of course, as is well known, a passage does not need to use the term covenant for the notion to be there. But here in Genesis 22, the language explicitly recalls Genesis 12, 1 through 3. Excuse me here. Okay. For example, in Genesis 22, God commands Abram, take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go forth to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain I will show you. This recalls the very similar threefold progression in Genesis 12. Go forth from your country, your people, and your father's household. In both cases, the intensity and the intimacy of what is at stake increases step by step. Then, the end of the chapter, it comes back again to the beginning of the Abraham narratives to tie it all together. I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and as the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies. And through your offspring, all nations on earth will be blessed because you have obeyed me. More could be said about the details, but the reason the land promise is not treated in Genesis 22 is not to de-emphasize the land, but because what was at stake in the chapter was the seed. It has nothing to do with the land promise being somehow secondary. So how do we get from Abraham to Jesus, the new covenant, and the church? One of the best ways to follow the historical progression, progressive sequence of God's redemptive covenants from the Abrahamic covenant to the Mosaic, Davidic, and New Covenants, I have found, is this umbrella chart that I'm going to display here now. The Abrahamic covenant is the overarching umbrella under which the Mosaic covenant fits. The Davidic covenant likewise fits under both the Mosaic and Abrahamic covenants. The New Covenant umbrella stretches out to match the Abrahamic because it fulfills the promise that God will bless all the peoples of earth through Abram. The dotted lines down the sides of the chart from the earlier covenants to the new covenant are intended to indicate that each of the three earlier covenants have continued effect in the New Testament. The diagonal lines that run through the cross at the peak of the New Covenant umbrella are meant to indicate that these earlier covenants come through into the new covenant in ways that are transformed by the nature of the new covenant ministry of Christ and the community of the faithful known as the church in the New Testament. The church, for example, is not a nation. So many of the national features of the Old Testament covenants do not come through directly, but in a way that corresponds to the nature of God's kingdom program in and through the church under the new covenant. You may also have noticed that under each umbrella, there are passages cited to indicate that each of these covenants combines both promise and obligation, by which I mean permanent promise and ongoing obligation. It has been common in some circles, at least, to distinguish between conditional and unconditional covenants. The Abrahamic and Davidic covenants are often considered unconditional or grant covenants. And the Mosaic and sometimes the New Covenant are considered conditional or administrative covenants. There has been much written on this through the centuries and even in recent years. As it turns out, however, this is not a good way to treat the covenants. First, the text does not support it because the so-called unconditional covenants are sometimes articulated in the Bible as if they are conditional, and vice versa. Second, the ancient Near Eastern textual support that is often called forth to support this distinction cannot carry the weight that some scholars have placed on it. God made the Abrahamic covenant with the head of a family. So it is a family-level covenant meant to regulate and guide a family as they walk with the Lord. By the time God delivered them from Egypt, however, the family had grown into a nation. So the Mosaic covenant is a national-level covenant. It was designed to guide and regulate a nation in their relationship with the Lord, not just a family. Similarly, the Davidic covenant fits under both the Abrahamic and Mosaic covenants. The family had grown into a nation that needed a king. So this is a dynastic covenant. The Davidic kings were expected to have Abrahamic faith in the Lord and rule the nation according to the law of Moses. In fact, when he ascended to the throne, he was to write his own copy of the law under the supervision of the Levitical priests so that he could read and study the law all the days of his life and rule according to it. It is not possible in this short paper to discuss all the details and the various passages of Scripture this chart is intended to illustrate. 2 points remain, however, that I think are essential to our discussion this evening. The first comes from Leviticus 26, verses 40 through 45, the conclusion to the blessings and curses of the Mosaic covenant made at Sinai. The Mosaic covenant fits under the Abrahamic umbrella because there would be no Mosaic covenant if it were not for the covenant commitment that God made to Israel's patriarchal fathers. The assumption is that the nation of Israel would consist of a people known for their Abrahamic faith in the Lord. Of course, historically, this was not the case, and that is why the prophets railed against them with judgment oracles. Leviticus 26 anticipates the time when Israel would violate the Mosaic covenant so badly that they would be taken into exile out of the Holy Land. In hindsight, we know this refers to the Babylonian captivity many years later, many centuries later. The passage starts this way. But if, when they are in captivity, they will confess their sins and the sins of their ancestors, their unfaithfulness and their hostility toward me, which made me hostile toward them so that I sent them into the land of their enemies, then when their uncircumcised hearts are humbled and they pay for their sin, I will remember my covenant with Jacob and my covenant with Isaac and my covenant with Abraham, and I will remember the land. The point here is that even when they're in captivity because of their sin, the Lord will still remain committed to the covenant he made with their patriarchal fathers, the Abrahamic covenant. The passage continues. For the land will be deserted by them, will enjoy its Sabbaths while it lies desolate without them. They will pay for their sins because they rejected my laws and abhorred my decrees. Since they will not have given the land its seven-year sabbatical rest, it would make up for this while they were in captivity by getting its sabbatical years all at once. The passage closes with this. Yet in spite of this, when they are in the land of their enemies, I will not reject them or abhor them so as to destroy them completely, breaking my covenant with them. I am the Lord their God. But for their sake, I will remember the covenant with their ancestors whom I brought out of Egypt in the sight of the nations to be their God. I am the Lord. The covenant that God made when he brought them out of Egypt is the Mosaic covenant. Yes, they will have broken that covenant, but he still will not destroy them completely. Even though they have broken their covenant with him, he will still remain committed to his covenant with them, in this case referring to the Mosaic covenant. The point is that in this sense, the Mosaic covenant is just as permanent as the Abrahamic. How could it be otherwise, since the people of the Mosaic covenant were the descendants of Abraham and heirs of that covenant as well? In conclusion, let's turn to Romans 9 through 11. In Romans 9, 4 through 5, amid his great anguish about the fact that most of the Jews had rejected the gospel, Paul lists a number of great works of the redemptive grace God has historically worked through Israel, including the covenants. Theirs is the adoption to the sonship. Theirs the divine glory, the covenants, the receiving of the law, the temple worship, and the promises. Theirs are the patriarchs, and from them is traced the human ancestry of the Messiah, who is God over all, forever praised. Amen. He then makes note of the fact that not all who are descended from Israel are Israel, nor, because they are his descendants, are they all Abraham's children. His basic point is that not all the Israelites had Abrahamic faith. Then in Romans 11, he turns to the current situation in his own day as it relates to Jews and Gentiles and the kingdom of God. The first point the Apostle Paul makes here is that there is a remnant of the Jews already in the church. He was one of them. He likens the kingdom of the redeemed to an olive tree. Some of the natural branches, Jews, have been broken off, and you Gentiles, though a wild olive shoot, have been grafted in among the others and now share in the nourishing sap from the olive tree, olive root. These wild, crazy Gentile branches have been grafted in only because of their faith, and they need to remember this. You do not support the root, but the root supports you. Finally, if the Jews do not persist in unbelief, they will be grafted in again, for God is able to graft them in again. After all, they are the natural branches. They belong in the tree. Paul continues, verse 25, I do not want you to be ignorant of this mystery, brothers and sisters, so that you may not be conceited. Israel has experienced a hardening in part until the full number of the Gentiles has come in, and in this way, all Israel will be saved. The meaning of all Israel is much debated. Some have gone back to Romans 9 to find the meaning, since there we find the notion that not all Israel is true Israel of the faith of Abraham. But here in Romans 11, Paul has already made the point that there is a remnant of Jews already in the church. He is talking here about so-called natural branches, the Jews being grafted back in. This is more than a remnant. There is a mystery here, according to verse 25. The term used is the same as that used in Ephesians 3 for the mystery of the church that was not known to previous generations. There, the mystery is the inclusion of the Gentiles as heirs of God's kingdom work through the Jews. No one saw that coming in the way that God made it happen through Christ. The book of Acts attests to this. Here in Romans 11, the mystery is reversed. It is about grafting the Jews back into their own kingdom tree. How will God do this, and what will it all look like? I suspect that we will all be surprised, kind of like Peter was in Acts chapter 10. The following verses, however, make it clear that it is in accordance with God's previous covenant commitments. As far as the gospel is concerned, they are enemies for your sake. But as far as election is concerned, they are loved on account of the patriarchs. For God's covenants and his call are irrevocable. In my view, based on the analysis of the biblical text presented above, this will include Israel in their land with faith in Yeshua, their Messiah. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Averbeck. Our third presentation this evening will be given by Dr. Mitch Glaser, who is the president of Chosen People Ministries. Dr. Glaser was born into a nominally Orthodox Jewish home in New York City at a time in the last century when views on life and death and religion were undergoing all sorts of changes in our society. His religious roots were soon lost, not terribly long after his bar mitzvah, and he turned away from that to pursue the excitement and energy of the 1960s. Well, in the early 1970s, Dr. Glaser moved to California and was introduced to various Eastern religions, which were quite intriguing to him, and yet they didn't answer the questions of his soul. But thankfully, the Lord was there, and after two of his closest friends received Jesus as Messiah, Dr. Glaser first heard the message that Jesus was the Jewish Messiah. And after he read the New Testament and studied messianic prophecies in the Hebrew scriptures, Dr. Glaser himself received Jesus as his Messiah in November of 1970. Well, almost immediately after becoming a believer, Dr. Glaser became involved in Jewish missions and served there on the West Coast with the local branch of Chosen People Ministries. And that really was the start of some 40 years of ministry that has included working with Jews for Jesus and aerial ministries. But since 1997, Dr. Glaser has served as president of Chosen People Ministries, which is one of the oldest and largest messianic missions in the United States. Dr. Glaser did his undergraduate work at Northeastern Bible College. He then did his Master of Divinity work in Old Testament from Talbot School of Theology and received a PhD in Intercultural Studies from the Fuller Theological Seminary School of Intercultural Studies. He is also an author as well as a missionary. He is co-author of the Fall Feasts of Israel with his wife, Zahava, who also just a few years ago received her PhD. And he is co-editor of a work entitled To the Jew First. And he is also editor of The Gospel According to Isaiah 53 and The People, the Land, and the Future of Israel, which was published recently by Kregel Publications. Dr. Glaser's evangelistic book, Isaiah 53 Explained, is now in 11 languages with over 100,000 copies in print. He's written many articles for Christian periodicals, and he's taught at leading evangelical schools such as Talbot School of Theology, Fuller Theological Seminary, Moody Bible Institute, Columbia International University, and also as a visiting professor at TEDS. Now, if you were in chapel this morning, you also know that Dr. Glaser is a musician, and he favored us with a number. In addition to playing, he also composes, and of course, he is a very gifted teacher. He is married to Zahava, who is a native of Argentina, and her intellectual studies culminated in receiving a PhD in Jewish history from the City University of New York just a few years ago. Dr. Glaser and his wife both teach at the Charles Feinberg Center for Messianic Jewish Studies, that sounds familiar, a partnership between Chosen People Ministries and the Talbot School of Theology. It's a real pleasure and privilege to have him with us this week. We've been enjoying fellowship and his ministry to us. And he comes this evening to present a premillennial dispensational perspective on the question of whatever happened to Israel's promised kingdom. Please welcome with me Dr. Mitch Glaser.
Shalom, good evening. Thank you for coming. None of us like to be theologically pigeonholed these days, and I'm no different. But it'd be easy to understand what I'm about to say if I told you where I stood. I've come to the conclusion that if forced to identify, I am either a traditional progressive dispensationalist or maybe a progressively traditional dispensationalist. I grew up in a Jewish home who was not exactly an expert on either the New or Old Testament. I think when I first heard the word eschatology, I thought it was a disease. After becoming a follower of Jesus in 1970, I went to Bible college after those trying to disciple me were exasperated. The school I went to was Northeastern Bible College in Essex Fells, New Jersey. It's where I was taught Bible and theology. Northeastern offered a course, a core course in dispensationalism. It was taught by the president of the college. And we used Dr. Ryrie's book, Dr. Ryrie just recently went to be with the Lord, called Dispensationalism Today. I had a historic premillennialist for Ezekiel, Daniel, and the book of Revelation, a four-point Calvinist for Bible doctrine, a classically trained Princeton five-point Calvinist for systematic theology, and a post-tribulationalist for advanced hermeneutics. I went to Talbot Seminary to recover and get straightened out because as a Jewish believer, I certainly hope the promises to Israel found in the Old Testament would one day be literally fulfilled in the redemption of Israel and that the church had not replaced Israel. I had a traditional dispensationalist, Dr. Charles Feinberg, close relative of someone who just introduced me, and others at Talbot as professors, the late Dr. Robert Saucy, for the majority of my theology classes, including ecclesiology and eschatology. I did not know he was a progressive dispensationalist, and nor did he, for that matter, as the position had not yet been named. Finally, I went to Fuller for my PhD and studied under Art Glaser, one of the finest missionary theologians of the last century, who is a traditionally Reformed Presbyterian historic premillennialist. So, am I eclectic or confused? As in the case of all of us, I know that I would like the words, he believed the Bible, to be on my gravestone. And so allow me to take a few minutes responding to this question of the coming kingdom by reminding us of how the classical or traditional dispensationalists might answer this question formulated by Dr. Feinberg. And I'll try to respond as a pan-dispensationalist and reflect the positions of classical, moderate, and progressive dispensationalists. And I'll also try to speak for those who are dispensational but are trying to remain theologically cool by not using the term. Or are making up some very hip-sounding theological phrases, but underneath, they are still dispensational. So I'll focus my response on four questions that grow out of the topic. The first one is defining the kingdom. So I'll give you sort of a traditional dispensational view, which is my eclectic view of what I think this means. So traditional dispensationalists emphasize the more literal aspects of the kingdom of God, which include the following elements: the return of Jesus after the rapture, 7 years of great tribulation, to sit on the throne of David and rule from Jerusalem for a literal 1,000 years. At the conclusion of the millennial kingdom, there'll be further purging of non-believers. The devil and his followers will be thrown into the lake of fire. And you'll forgive me that I did not bring charts. The new heavens and earth will come down from heaven in the eternal state. Heaven would begin. The millennial kingdom literally fulfills the prophetic promises of the Old Testament to the Jewish people of an earthly kingdom where the curse of sin would be lifted, Israel would become the head of the nations and not the tail, and once again, Jesus will reign from Jerusalem with the church as his co-regents. This is a simple description of the coming kingdom that most dispensationalists would accept in one form or another. However, there are some other earmarks of the position that grow out of this expectation and that are truly foundational to the dispensational view of the kingdom of God. So I'm going to list 7 of these marks. Notice 7. 1, a distinction between national Israel and the church, perhaps the greatest hallmark of the dispensational position. The unconditional nature of the Abrahamic covenant. The continued election of the Jewish people. A literal hermeneutic as applied to the prophecies of the Old Testament, which, by the way, amillennialists, postmillennialists, millennialists, and everybody believes that their hermeneutic is literal. 5, the literal return of the Jewish people to the land of Israel in the last days. 6, the rapture of the church, traditionally probably the pre-tribulational rapture of the church. A season of 7 years of great tribulation. And finally, 7, the end time turning of the Jewish remnant to Jesus. Historically, this is essentially what dispensationalists have emphasized throughout the years. What today does not seem to be as important to modern dispensationalists are as follows: the juxtaposition of the rapture and the tribulation period, pre, post, mid, and I'm sure there will be more views to come. The length of the millennial kingdom, 1,000 years literally, or who knows. The classical view of 7 dispensations, there might be 6. The infrastructure of the dispensations, the hope of a physical kingdom as opposed to one that is spiritual in nature. So that gives you an overview, an idea of how dispensationalists might look at these matters. Now, what happened when Israel said no to Jesus? This is an important question from a dispensational point of view. The traditional dispensationalist view, and I would agree, mostly, that God responded to the Jewish rejection of the king by sending the son to the cross, and after the resurrection, the king ascended to heaven to sit at the Father's right hand until the day he would return to reign as king in a literal kingdom on earth. In effect, Israel blew it, and Jesus left without establishing his literal kingdom and initiated the establishment of the church, which had previously been a mystery to the Old Testament saints. So, in other words, the kingdom was postponed. That is the traditional dispensational view, and I accept that as in one form or another. Third question I would like to address is, did the church inherit the kingdom? Did it? The church and the kingdom of God are differentiated, I believe, in God's program. And that would be the position of most dispensationalists. We're currently in the church age, which will last until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in, and the church has been removed from the earth in the rapture. Then all Israel that endured the great tribulation will be saved, Romans 11:25, and the millennial kingdom will be initiated at the second coming of Jesus. Now, another question, and that is, what is Israel's relationship to the kingdom? I believe that dispensationalists would say, and I would say, that Jesus will return and establish the millennial kingdom. Jesus will return and make Jerusalem his capital. At that time, all the promises of the Abrahamic covenant will literally be fulfilled, and the Jewish people will enjoy the literal fulfillment of the kingdom of God. As Isaiah wrote, "And the wolf will lie down with the lamb, the leopard will lie down with the young goat, the calf and the young lion, and the fatling together, and a little boy will lead them, and the cow and the bear will graze. Their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The nursing child will play by the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child will put his hand in the viper's den. They will not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth will be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. Then in that day the nations will resort to the root of Jesse, who will stand as a signal for the peoples, and his resting place will be glorious. I believe every word, literally. His second coming will be as literal as his first coming. There's no reason to envision this forever rule of Jesus on the throne of David to be anything more than a literal reign over a literal kingdom one day in the future. So that is the basic position of dispensationalists in my interpretation. Now, what do I really believe about all of this? Well, glad you asked. So, first of all, let's talk about, the kingdom of God defined. The only addition I would make to the traditional dispensational understanding of the kingdom is that there is a spiritual dimension to the kingdom, which I believe was initiated on the day of Pentecost, even though the fullness of the literal kingdom is yet to come. That makes me traditionally progressive, or something like that. But I think that there is a here and there state of the kingdom. Secondly, the results of Israel's rejection of the king. The promised literal kingdom was not redefined because Israel rejected her king. It was simply delayed. The king had offered the Jewish people the opportunity to embrace their promised Davidic king, leading to the establishment of the kingdom, but he was rejected. The king left and ascended to sit at the right hand of the Father. And I'll leave the discussion of plan A's and plan B's to those who adore Greek thought patterns. But I don't think we need to parse it at this time. This paved the way for the current church age, where God's focus on the nation of Israel temporarily shifts to a focus on the church. However, Israel was not permanently rejected for her unbelief, but rather served God's purposes in bringing Gentiles to a saving knowledge of his Son. As Paul writes in Romans 10, 19 through 21, just read a little bit, I was found by those who did not seek me, became manifest to those who did not ask for me. But as for Israel, he says, all day long I've stretched out my hands to a disobedient and obstinate people. In other words, the inclusion of the Gentiles, a mystery to us, did not take God by surprise. God used the rejection of the king to open the doors of salvation to the Gentiles. It does not mean the Jewish people would be replaced or rejected forever, as God would also be faithful to his promises, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable, Romans 11, 29. Dr. Bob Sosi says this about the inclusion of the church. The church is the fruit of the message of the inaugurated kingdom, is essentially a spiritual community destined to live in a hostile world until the coming of Christ. It continues a mission similar to Israel as a witness to God's glory in the world as ambassadors of Jesus and his coming kingdom, but it does not fulfill Israel's calling as a national witness. That will be fulfilled with the coming of the Messiah, his judgment of the nations, and the restoration of the nation of Israel and his kingdom's reign on earth. In other words, God remains faithful to his promises to the Jewish people, as Paul describes in Romans 11, 25. The day is coming when the Jewish rejection of Jesus will be overturned and the Jewish people will return to the rejected king. The relationship of the church to the kingdom, maybe this is at the heart of a whole lot of what we're trying to say tonight. And we're discussing whether or not Israel has been replaced by the church. That's a very important part of our discussion. And I am happy to say that we are charitably discussing this. The assured future of Israel in God's plan, rooted in the Abrahamic covenant, does not make the church or Gentile salvation an afterthought. Nothing could be further from the truth. Dispensationalists believe that God's plan always included the Gentiles, and there is only one way to be saved, through Jesus. all dispensationalists are saying is that the inclusion of the Gentiles does not demand the rejection of the Jewish people. As God promised Abraham, in you all the families of the earth will be blessed. I agree with traditional dispensationalists who do not believe that the kingdom took on a different, more spiritual format because of the Jewish rejection of Jesus. We are mere humans and simply did not understand that the kingdom of God would come in stages. First, the more predominantly spiritual version, and then when Israel repents, a more literal form of the kingdom when he would reign on the throne, similar to our understanding of first and second coming. As so many Jewish people say to me, if the Messiah had come, then the dead would be raised, Israel would have her kingdom, and everything would be hunky-dory and everybody would have everything they wanted. Think of the second coming as a penultimate Hanukkah, is what we call it. Or Christmas for some of you. Okay? And yet, that hasn't happened yet. Does that mean that the Messiah hasn't come? No. The Messiah has come, and surprise, even though it's right there in the Old Testament, he was first to die for our sins, rise from the dead, ascend to the right hand of the Father, and to wait until it's his time to come again. There are two comings. I don't believe that the univocal intent of the prophetic word was altered due to Israel's rejection of Jesus. This type of thinking sometimes deconstructs the literal nature of God's promise. We don't need to deconstruct anything. Everything that he said will happen. It's just that more happened than we thought would happen. Though I believe the king and his kingdom was partially enacted at Pentecost, I would not say that this is the fullness of the predicted kingdom, nor does the church replace the Jewish people. As Paul beautifully describes in the olive tree illustration, the Gentiles who turn to Jesus are added to the olive tree and now become partakers of the nourishment provided by the rich or fat root of the olive tree, as the apostle writes also in Ephesians 2, remember that you were at that time separate from Christ, excluded from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world, but now in Messiah Yeshua, you who were formerly far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. As Dr. Soce also mentions, the present church age does not constitute an interruptive parenthetical period within the outworking of the prophesied salvation of the Messianic kingdom. Rather, progressive dispensationalism, which was his position, sees God's present activity in and through the church as the already of an already not yet understanding of the outworking of the prophesied kingdom. The fulfillment of the not yet of messianic salvation will only come with the return of Jesus and his righteous reign on earth. Number four, the glorious future of Israel and the Jewish people. Global Abrahamic blessings. I do not believe that the literal kingdom promises found in the Old Testament were spiritually fulfilled in the church. In other words, there was an element, a spiritual element of the kingdom that came to pass with the church, but you cannot confuse the church with the kingdom. I do, however, believe that a literal kingdom is still coming, and this kingdom will be inclusive of the Gentiles, as it has always been God's intention to bless the world through his chosen people. This is the clear teaching of God's word through the scripture, beginning with the Abrahamic covenant and built into the very fabric of Israel's election and calling. For example, Exodus 19:6. And you shall be a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. Who was Israel to be a kingdom of priests for? The Gentiles. Isaiah 49:9-11. You are my witnesses, declares the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, so that you may now believe in me and understand that I am he. Witnesses to who? Who is in court? The Gentiles were in court. And so God brought Israel out as his star witness to show the Gentiles that he is the one true God and faithful to his covenants and promises. Traditional Judaism also teaches that the Jewish people were chosen by God for the sake of the Gentiles. It's clear from the word of God that the blessings Israel brought to the Gentiles through disobedience will only be expanded when Israel turns to the Messiah and the literal kingdom promises of the Old Testament comes to pass. Paul writes in Romans 11:12, that their transgression is riches for the world, their failure is riches for the Gentiles, how much more will their fulfillment be? In effect, and this might be a new way of thinking about it for some of you, the creation of the church is a foretaste of the kingdom of God for the Gentiles. The literal kingdom that's coming will bring even greater blessings to the Gentiles because the king will reign on his rightful throne, and as Jeremiah promised at the conclusion of his great New Covenant prophecy, they will not teach again each man his neighbor and each man his brother, saying, "Know the Lord," for they will all know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, declares the Lord. The church was never to be the conclusion of God's penultimate plan for the Gentiles. The kingdom is the capstone of God's plan for the Gentiles. And so the best is yet to come, not just for Israel, the best is yet to come for the Gentiles when Jesus returns and the Gentiles take their place next to a redeemed Israel to enjoy God's kingdom. The repentance of Israel and the return of Jesus. In preaching in Acts chapter 3, verses 17 through 21, Peter gave a Billy Graham-like invitation and said, "Now, brethren, I know that you acted in ignorance, just as your rulers did also, but the things which God announced beforehand by the mouth of all the prophets, that is, Christ would suffer, he has thus fulfilled. Therefore, repent and return, so that your sins may be wiped away, in order that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus, the Messiah, appointed from you, for you, whom heaven must receive until the period of restoration." And then in Matthew 23, verses 37 through 39, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets, stones those who were sent to her, how I wanted to gather your children together as a hen would gather her chicks under her wings. Behold, your house," a reference to the temple, "is being left to you desolate," 70 AD. "For I say to you, from now on, you will not see me until you say," and you know the words, "Baruch haba b'shem Adonai, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." The only point I want to make here is that the kingdom has been postponed until an end-time remnant of Jewish people turns to Jesus as Savior and Lord. And when the Jewish people turn to Jesus, then Jesus returns and establishes his kingdom, literally. In conclusion, many of our greatest theologians believe that the literal kingdom will come, and it will include the salvation of the Jewish people, the blessings to the Gentiles, and the return of the Jewish people to their land. Perhaps one of the great signs of his soon appearing, indicating that we're living on the precipice of the second coming, is the regathering of the Jewish people to the land of Israel. This is a sign that the literal kingdom and the literal kingdom promises to Israel and the Jewish people will come to pass. However you feel about the return of the Jewish people to the promised land, you have to admit, it's pretty awesome. Really miraculous. None other than Carl Henry himself, writing in the book, The Jerusalem Conference on Prophecy in 1971, which included messages by some great evangelical leaders of the last century, including at that time the president of Dallas Seminary and the president of Westminster Seminary, and Arnold Olson, for whom this chapel is named. Carl Henry comments on the return of the Jewish people. He's in Israel, commenting on the return of the Jewish people. Henry says this: "On your long flight to the Holy Land, the moment finally came when you saw the flashing signal, fasten your seatbelts. The closing hour of the journey was near. With a further no smoking message, you knew the actual moment of touchdown now awaited, only a clearance from the control tower. So it is with the expectant church, with all the light of prophecy signaling the final arrival hour at hand, with all the prophetic signs exhorting preparedness, she readies for a momentary landing. Here in the land of promise, many of us interpret the regathering of Israel from the ends of the earth as one fulfillment of the prophetic word. We anticipate a further fulfillment of that same word in the risen one's return, when men shall behold him whom they have pierced. Even so, come, Lord Jesus, and may thy kingdom come." Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Glaser. We are now going to shift gears for just a little bit. I'm going to ask our three presenters to come to the stage, and as they're doing that, we're going to ask you if you would like to stand and stretch for just a moment or so, and then we're going to ask you to reseat yourself, and each of our presenters then will speak for approximately 5 minutes, and we've instructed them that they are free to elaborate their views, to defend them, to, if they want, I guess, attack the other positions, whatever you'd like to do. And that's going to last for approximately 15 minutes. If you have a question that you've written on one of those sheets that you find there on the seats, if you would give that to Jeff. Okay, we have people here to collect them. And then we're going to take a few minutes after each of our presenters have had a time to respond to one another and see if we can answer a few questions. So, if we could be seated, we want to continue. And I think in light of the time, we should probably ask each of the presenters to use in the neighborhood of about 5 minutes. We're going to follow the same format that we did. Dr. Pratt will come first, then Dr. Averbeck, and then Dr. Glaser. And I think that we'll just ask them to come one after another rather than me getting up and doing that. We'll save a little bit of time that way. So Dr. Pratt, please.
You want me to go up there? Oh.
Yes, okay.
What I love about what's happened this evening is that there is much more in common than there is different among us. And one of the things I would like to hear you comment on is how your views, both of you, involve or require what I talked about in my talk, the God's responsiveness to his people and to others after times of prediction, and how God's responsiveness affects the fulfillment of the promises, fulfillment of predictions and the like. So what do you think?
Again, to the Gentile first.
That sounds backwards to me.
Matt, you want me to rephrase it?
No, I think I understand what you're asking. Am I supposed to go up?
Come on.
Okay.
Me tres amigos.
smile for the camera, Dick.
Okay. Well, there are lots of indications in Scripture that when God speaks to a prophet to say what's going to be happening, there's an implicit in it, and then sometimes explicitly it comes out, that God wants people to repent so he doesn't need to do this judgment or whatever. Joel 2 is a classic example, Jonah, you know what I mean, these kind of things. And so I see this as built into the way God is doing his kingdom work. Okay, he's actually built in. He's not kind of wound it up at the beginning and then let it go and everything's determined, you know what I mean, that kind of thing. He's directly involved, dynamically working his plan, okay, along the way. And he's calling us to be responsive to that plan. And that is part of what God has built into the way he's going to work his plan.
Right.
So that's the way I see the question that you're asking.
Right. And, the wonderful thing, I think, the practical implication for a group like this or like us is that what this tells us is that the goal is not to take the pieces of prophecy in the Bible, like pieces of a jigsaw puzzle, and fit them all together into one composite portrait, because there is a dynamism that occurs that results in various ways in which God does fulfill his promises and his predictions, or sometimes does the opposite, things like that. But I that's what I like about this, because what I think it does is it provides the language you used was not one of, I'm going to take this literally, and I'm going to take this piece, and I'm going to fit it in here. There, you recognize that God responds to repentance, or to obstinance, for that matter, Jeremiah 18, etc., even when it comes to the distant eschatological end time prophecies.
There is the other side of it, too, I think, and that is God has simply determined certain things. Already.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he has his plan, and he has certain things that he's going to do. And so on. But within that, there's all this dynamic mm-hmm. that's going on. And so we need to take seriously when God says, this is something I'm committed to, okay? But then realize that within that, all sorts of things can happen.
Right.
In relation to it.
Mitch?
Yes. Yeah, I enjoyed that. I don't know if I can repeat the word. I kept writing it down. Hold on, I got it.
IHC, intervening historical contingencies?
Intervening historical contingencies. I got it.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's it's the nature of the biblical story.
Right.
Because even what you have is, and like, as I mentioned, is you have a plan. God always intended to include the Gentiles. Not just in the church, but also in the kingdom. But the way that he included the Gentiles was by allowing the Jewish people to say no at the first coming. He could have done it another way. Mm-hmm. And that was a tough way for him to do it. So God always intended to bring his kingdom to pass through and for the Jewish people, and yet allowed human interaction to say no to Jesus so that the Gentiles could come in. And he always intended the Gentiles to come in also. So you have both happening all the time. So you have God's sovereign plan and you have man's responsibility. And that's the name of the game. That's the story,
that's
isn't
right.
it?
Yeah.
And that's so encouraging for us because we know that no matter how much we blow it, that God is faithful, and we can trust his plan, and that he'll be faithful not only to Israel and to the nations, but faithful to us. And because we ourselves have our own intervening historical contingencies.
That's right. So. Good, wonderful. I'll close with this comment, and then I'll pass to you, as I think I'm supposed to do, right? One of the wonderful things I think that we can embrace together is also how the New Testament interprets and applies Old Testament prophecies like we're talking about in ways that we would never have imagined that this is the way it's going to unfold. Simply reading Amos 9 is not what you would expect Peter to say what was said in Acts 15 about Amos chapter 9.
Right.
About the Sukkot David rising up and conquering the world and all those sorts of things. And so I think it's amazing that if there's a Gentile here tonight, along with me, who thinks that somehow they've replaced Israel, then they need to remember that they serve a king, and this king is the king of the Jews. And they have to remember that they serve apostles who were Jewish. And they have to remember that they're following a book that was written with one perhaps possible exception of Luke, perhaps, and even that's questionable, Jewish. Okay? So if you don't think you've been conquered by the king of the Jews and that you've been incorporated into the kingdom of Israel as promised by the prophets of old, then you're grossly mistaken. This new covenant of which we are part now is not a covenant with Gentiles. Jeremiah 31:31 says, I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. I am making it with Israel. Now, we Gentiles got lucky, Calvinistically speaking. Okay? And we get baptized into that family and incorporated in as Gentiles often were throughout the history of the Old Testament. But this is the wonder of it, which is why when I sometimes am involved in trialogues with where you have the rabbi, the imam, and the Presbyterian preacher, you've heard that joke before, right? Well, I've been a part of that joke, okay? And it's very interesting because I am greatly indebted to the rabbi who's sitting there, even though not a follower of Yeshua. in ways that I am not indebted to the imam that's sitting next to me. Usually I'm in the middle. But and so there's a great deference to them because I received this faith in Christ from them. And that kind of commitment to Israel, to ethnic Israel, is a very important part of my own personal faith. Yours.
Okay. I think that one of the terms that stuck out to me as I was writing this particular paper was this term mystery. Mm-hmm. Even in not just Ephesians 2 and Ephesians 3, but the same term in Romans 11. And so I guess, how do we talk about that term is my question in relation to what's going on in this whole issue of the grafting back in, as it's talking about there in that chapter. How much mystery is there in it for us? And sometimes we have to ask this question in terms of even the current situation with Israel in the land right now. Okay? How sure are we about what's really going on here? These are questions that I would like to ask to both of you, really. What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, Carl Henry was sure of what was going on. So, I mean, who am I to disagree with Carl Henry? I think also of course, I deal with these topics like you do all the time, but when we prepare for something like this, we're always learning new things, and some things are solidifying. Mm-hmm. And for me, it was the major point in my understanding of the mystery is that that the church as a mystery was not a mystery to God. It was just a mystery to man. Mm-hmm. And so Gentile inclusion, and actually I'm quoting Daryl Bach here. I have to give him credit. But Gentile inclusion never demanded Jewish exclusion. And I think that's where things go wrong here. You know, that's what goes wrong in the discussion. As a Messianic Jew, we were very happy to have the Gentiles part of the church, you know, and join us in the olive tree, you know. And we're very happy for the Gentiles to join us in the future kingdom when Jesus returns.
Thank you.
You're welcome. So, you know, sit under my olive tree. And so we're very happy about this. What we're not happy about is when the Gentiles get all this inclusion and the Jews get shown the door. And so that's the part that we don't like. So I think that the mystery probably has a dual fulfillment, one in the church and one in the future kingdom. Maybe the one in the future kingdom is not quite as mysterious. But I think the relationship between Gentiles in the church and then Gentiles in the future kingdom, that relationship might be mysterious. In other words, we didn't expect it to be in two parts, just like the first and second coming. I think they're very similar. But it's the exclusion of the Jewish people, I think, that is the rub for a lot of us. And I think that as we look at various theological positions, I think that you can have God's intended role for the Gentiles without having the Jewish people replaced or superseded by the church.
Yeah, the mystery, of course, as you know, is rooted in Deuteronomy 29:29. Things revealed belong to us and our children. Secret things belong to the Lord our God. Things revealed belong to us and to our children. But revelation has been has unfolded through history. And the apostle in Ephesians is saying that no one understood this until it was revealed to the apostles and prophets. And I've got it now. Here's the mystery. And it seems to me the heart of the mystery that Paul's dealing with is not so much the inclusion of Gentiles. It would never have been the exclusion of Jews per se or in toto. But not so much the inclusion of Gentiles, because that was true throughout the Bible. And it was also true in a very dramatic way, let's say in the genealogies of 1 Chronicles, the first nine chapters. But but what's important, it seems to me, and what was surprising was this sort of quantitative dimension, that there were so many Gentiles coming in while the Jews rejected in large measure, in large numbers. That was the shock, it seems to me. because in Acts 15, they're very quick to say that the reason evangelism is happening is because it is the house of David rising up and conquering the world, Amos chapter 9. It's fulfillment of the global conquest of Israel over all the Gentile nations. Baruch Hashem. Mm-hmm. Okay? And yet, how strangely it happened that it was a remnant of Israel who did this. And a king who ascended into heaven and now reigns until all of his enemies are put under his feet. So yeah, I think it's magnificent. But it never meant the exclusion of ethnic Jews from the church. As you pointed out, Paul says, that can't be. I'm here. Mm-hmm. What's wrong with the rest of you? Can't you tell I'm a Benjamite? It will never happen without that. Impossible. And so, yeah, it's a wonderful thing. Now, I think also, if I could say, I look at Romans 11, for example, as more of a call to activation than a prognostication of what's going to happen. Rather, a threat to the Gentiles who do things like become Nazis, mm-hmm. who do things like become anti-Semitic, and who think that they replace Israel. That threat against them, not the promise that you're out next week, but the threat against them that they don't humble themselves. Mm-hmm. And then the call to Israel to join, to come to Messiah. And so, yeah, that's more or less the way I look at those kinds of passages. So, yeah.
I guess I should take my turn.
Sure.
Okay. So I think one of the core issues here that, of course, we don't have tons of time to discuss are the issues, again, of biblical interpretation, of hermeneutics. And we use the word literal quite a bit. And sometimes we have different variations on what we mean by literal. I think we'd all agree that apocalyptic literature should be interpreted one way and narrative another way and so on. But let me illustrate it this way. I was going to a church and having a great discussion with my pastor, and we were on different sides of this issue. He was a little more of a classic amillennialist to my whatever kind of dispensationalist I think I am. And so we were on sort of a little bit on different sides. He was much more traditional amillennialist. And so we were talking about Israel's future role, and he didn't see much of a role. And he said, if you look at the New Testament writers' interpretation of Old Testament kingdom promises, Peter and so on, that it seems that the apostles believed that the Old Testament promises of a literal kingdom were fulfilled in the church. And now, the church includes both Jews and Gentiles, so we're not just saying it's just Gentiles. And I said, well, how can that really be? I mean, some of these prophecies in the Old Testament have definitely not been fulfilled. And the wolf's definitely not lying down with the lamb, and all sorts of other things haven't happened. Daniel, the end of Daniel 2, and I mean, you just go on and on and on. And I said, so do you think that because the New Testament quotes some of these promises being fulfilled spiritually in the church, that therefore all of the Old Testament promises should now be taken as fulfilled in the church, and that even those elements of these promises that, if taken more literally, clearly haven't come to pass, that we should still deem the ones that are not even mentioned in the New Testament as being fulfilled in the church? And he said, yes. I thought it was an extreme view. And so I think that we, you know, you can call it dual fulfillment on some of these promises, or you can talk about expanded fulfillment. But I think that we have to understand that the promises, these literal promises, cannot be spiritualized. There can be an element of them that maybe has been fulfilled, particularly if addressed by a New Testament writer, but not the end of it. So I think that we need to see that there's a very literal element to the fulfillment of kingdom promises. I will close just by quoting one of them. Okay? So in Isaiah 9, 6, and 7. In Isaiah 9, 6, and 7, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace, and so on, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And then at the end of 7 is what really makes the difference. And there will be no end to the increase of his government, and upon the throne of his father David, he will reign forever. So there needs to happen a literal Jewish kingdom in order for that promise to be fulfilled. And so I just wonder what you brothers think about that.
Make your choice. You want me to go first or second?
You know me.
Okay, let me tell you this. Yes.
Good.
Okay, with one exception. The way I look at it is this. Dr. Kaiser, are you still here? We deferred to him and the great importance of the original intention of a text.
Yes.
Okay. And so we must take prophecies as they were originally intended to be, especially prophecies that have to do with the time of restoration, the end times. That's the same thing, by the way, the last days, or the kingdom. Same thing, Isaiah 52. They're all about restoration after exile, so on and so forth. But then the New Testament explains that these things unfold in ways that were unexpected, this mysterious way. So you're right to say that you should never take these, in quotes, air quotes now, spiritual fulfillments, which I really don't like, but I'll just go for it, spiritual fulfillments as replacement of the, as you said, literal fulfillments, but rather as preludes to. And that's nothing more than what we speak when we use the phrase now but not yet. That's all that is. Simply say it's unfolding. The eschaton, the last days, are unfolding from the first coming of Christ now and into the second coming of Christ. And as they do, these prophecies are fulfilled in a variety of ways. Mi Yodea, who knows exactly how? This is the mystery. We will have to wait and see. But in the end, it will. This is my exception. In the end, it will not be, from my point of view, Jesus and Israel reigning over the earth for 1,000 years. It will be Jesus and the faithful of Israel reigning over the new heavens and the new earth forever. Forever.
So we're close.
Yeah, we're close.
We're close.
Which means that I, as a Gentile, will be subservient to you, Mitch, forever, not just for 1,000 years.
I think you've persuaded me.
You like that idea, huh? Isaiah 60 says, I'm subservient to you in that day.
Well, now that is very interesting because that leads to one of the questions that's been asked. And I think I should ask this of all three of our presenters. One of our audience has asked, will Christian Jews receive more than other Christians? Whatever happened to no Jew nor Gentile?
Well, I think I have too much skin in the game to answer that objectively. Maybe you ought to give it a try, Dick.
In my view, being in Christ, okay, is what it's all about for everybody. And I think the Apostle Paul says that, okay? All of it's by mercy, you know what I mean, and so on. And so I think in terms of the history of the work of God, there's all that heritage and so on that Paul talks about in Romans 9. But the fact of the matter is, at the foot of the cross, we're all on the same level. And we're all there purely by the mercy of God.
Yeah. I would just simply add that the new heavens and new earth is not going to be an egalitarian democracy. Mm-hmm. It's an empire. And some will be at his right hand and some at his left. Even now, the throne is surrounded by 24 elders, and they are Jews. They are not Gentiles. And then the martyrs are nearby as well. So the least shall be the greatest among us, whether Jew or Gentile, and God will sort all that out. How's that?
I think we have to separate between personal salvation and national covenants. I think that we're talking about the national covenants where Israel will take its proper role in God's plan. Those of us who are Messianic Jews get just as much of Jesus as any Gentile. And to the third part, are Jews the same as Gentiles and so on? Well, Paul said, no man, no woman, and so on. So There are obviously role distinctions today, and so I'm not the same as a woman, I'm not the same as a Gentile, and that doesn't mean we're better or worse, it just means that we all have different roles.
Well, let me ask a question that frequently is asked by people in a local church when you're doing a prophecy conference or even a message on prophecy. Do you think that the modern state of Israel is a fulfillment of biblical prophecy? And related to that, what do you think should be evangelical attitudes toward the modern state of Israel? And I ask this in part because you know there are going to be some evangelicals who are going to be listening very carefully to political candidates to figure out where they stand on Israel. And they will make up their mind about who to vote for or not to vote for in part on the basis of that. So do you think that the modern state of Israel is a fulfillment of prophecy, and what should evangelical attitudes be toward it?
Maybe we can have each of us answer that question. It's a juicy one, John. Thank you.
Yeah. All three of
you. You want to start, Richard?
Yeah, that was what I was asking Alexandria, Egypt. Okay? And that was an interesting place to give an answer, to give my answer to that in that context, which was half Christian, half Muslim, and in Egypt. Our bottom line is, I think that we can look upon what happened in 1948 and the like as an act of God's mercy in bringing the potential or the offer of the free offer of the gospel to Israel again. I do believe that the nations of the earth, especially Europe, owed this to Israel as a matter of justice. That is not to say, however, that I'm unconcerned with justice for the Palestinians, because I am deeply concerned about that as well. But I think that the fulfillment of prophecies about Israel's return to the land and the glorious kingdom to follow are dependent upon repentance. This is always the connection. But we do have to keep in mind that when Cyrus allowed Israel to go back to the land, sent them back to the land, that it was not because of their repentance, but rather to provide the opportunity, apparently, for repentance, the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. So it doesn't have to come one to, it can also come to one, is the point. So what we need, so again, if you think of prophecies as activating us rather than prognostications about what has to be, then the idea is, okay, they are there. There is an Israeli state. Now what do we do about it? You see, and the answer is to the Jew first and then to the Greek. Gentiles owing Israel a debt, then serving Israel and bringing the gospel to them and working for them, and those kinds of things, I think, is the answer to the question for me.
Dr. Averbeck?
I think that this part of the discussion is part of this musterion, okay? How are we going to get from the nation of Israel as it is now, which is not a believing, grafted back in group, okay? I mean, there's a lot happening in Israel right now in that regard. But how do we get from that to the grafted back in kingdom of messianic believers? And that's what I meant by talking about there's mystery in this. How's it going to happen? How does that relate to the existence and so on of the Jewish people? The thing that is so fascinating to me about this is the fact that with all that has happened with the Jewish people, from their time in Egypt in slavery all the way up till now, they've survived as a distinct group. Okay? This to me is really fascinating. This is part of that, I'm sure of it. Okay? But I'm not sure how we're gonna get from one to the other. That's the question that I have. And how much does that have to do with what's going on now in the politics of the world? I see it as a still mysterious in that regard.
Well, I'd like to just respond as well. I'm reading from Ezekiel 36, and maybe I'll begin at verse 23, and I know the hour is getting close, so I won't read too much. Verse 23, "And I will vindicate the holiness of my great name, which has been profaned among the nations, which you have profaned in their midst. Then the nations will know that I am the Lord, declares the Lord God, when I prove myself holy among you in their sight. So what will God do among the Jewish people that would prove him to be holy in the sight of the nations? Sounds like something quite remarkable. In verse 24, we read, for I will take you from the nations, gather you from all the lands, and bring you into your own land. It's a reaffirmation of the Abrahamic promises and of the land promises. But verse 25 is so important, because the prophet says, then I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your filthiness and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart, put a new spirit within you, remove the heart of stone from your flesh, give you a heart of flesh, put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes. You'll be careful to observe all my ordinances. So essentially, what the way I view it is that modern Israel is absolutely the fulfillment of prophecy, because based on Ezekiel 36, God would bring the Jewish people back to the land of Israel in the last days in unbelief. And if you go to Israel, you know right away that the Jewish people are not all believers in Jesus yet. If not, we'll take you on a chosen people tour. You'll figure it out, okay? And so we know that the Jewish people are not even Orthodox Jews, nevertheless followers of Jesus. And so I see the modern state of Israel as absolutely the fulfillment of prophecy, because God has brought the Jewish people back in unbelief, and he's brought them back, and that should astound the Gentiles, but the Gentiles are kind of numb because they've been watching CNN too much. And so the next thing on God's agenda and program is the sprinkling clean of the Jewish people. So God has brought the Jewish people from all across the globe back to the land of Israel, and it's in the land of Israel that he's going to pour out his spirit and restore the Jewish people spiritually, and then he's going to lift the curse, if you read the rest of the passage, and the nation of Israel, he says, will become like the Garden of Eden. And so so first comes regathering in unbelief, then spiritual restoration, and then physical restoration. And I believe I would equate that with the second coming of Jesus in there. So absolutely, I believe that Israel is, the modern Israel is the fulfillment of prophecy. How should believers relate to this? I think that we should love Israel, pray for the peace of Jerusalem. They will prosper who love thee. We should understand that God's plan says, gave the boundaries in Genesis chapter 15, and I think that Christians who believe the Bible and take it anywhere near literally should say, wow, this is quite amazing that God would bring the Jewish people back to the land. Does that mean that we should support Israel in every action? We don't even support ourselves in every action, nevertheless, Israel, okay? And so I think we understand the sinfulness and humanity of all of us, and so no, we don't. But we pray for the peace of Jerusalem, and as my brothers have said, that we seek to be part of God's next phase of seeing the Jewish people sprinkled clean and purified from their sins by being involved with Jewish evangelism and bringing the good news of the gospel to the Jewish people in Israel and around the world.
Great. Dr. Averbeck. Well, our time is just about up. Let me just ask one more question that's here. Thank you for those of you who submitted questions. These are really great. I wish we had time for all of them. Let me just ask this one. One of our audience asks, and this is for all three of you, how does the temple fit into each of the three positions? Is it to be rebuilt? Is Jesus the true temple? Why is there no temple in the New Jerusalem? Let me give this to you because it's multiple choice. And you could choose D, none of the above.
We just keep passing it around. That's nice. Here you go, Dave.
Want me to go first?
Sure.
Okay. From my point of view, the temple itself is on analogy with what the promised land was. In the sense that, remember how I said that the promised land was Omaha Beach? You got the illusion, yes? just the beginning point for the spread of the kingdom of God to the ends of the earth. Much like the Garden of Eden was the temple garden of God where his feet shuffled on the earth. Hit by oil there, mm-hmm. like
that's
that.
Good.
Mm-hmm. And then the job of humanity was to spread this holy place to the ends of the earth, to turn the whole world into the holy temple garden of God. So Israel's tabernacle and then Israel's temple, both its erection and then its collapse and then its rebuilding in the days of Zerubbabel and the like, these are all parts of this focus on the promised land, which was just Omaha Beach. Now in our day, because of the way the kingdom is unfolded mysteriously in the last days, we have to remember what the New Testament says and believe it. And they are things like that Jesus is the high priest who is up there, and therefore he functions by metonymy as the temple for us. He's not the last temple by any means. He's the high priest of the temple. And you are a part of the temple too, because you're a chosen people, a holy priesthood, and you're being built into this temple that's now filling up the whole world. Isn't it wonderful? And in the end, the reason that there's no temple in the new world is the same reason that you have the expansion to the globe. It's because the presence of God, the holy presence of God, is now everywhere. The whole earth will be his sanctuary, as was intended in the very beginning, when God said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth, subdue it, and have dominion over it.
I think for me, we have to, and this is one of the things that we haven't really talked too much about directly in this discussion, and that is even in the treatment of prophecies by the more traditional amillennialists, they will tend to put a lot of the things that you were talking about in terms of predictions into the new heaven and new earth, not into the kingdom stage. And so what happens is, okay, if we have a kingdom stage before the new heaven and new earth, okay,
yeah.
Which is part of what's
quite possible.
It's part of what we're trying to talk about, okay? If we have that, then the new heavens and new earth in 21-22 is not telling us necessarily what's going to be happening and how it's going to be happening in the kingdom age, okay? If there's a separate kingdom age leading to that. So that doesn't really solve the issue about what about this temple issue in relationship to a kingdom age, okay? Now, people have talked about Ezekiel 40 through 48 in connection with all of this and so on. I really am not sure whether there's going to be a rebuilt temple or not, but I don't see any reason there couldn't be in the millennial or kingdom age. The reason is because if Jesus is ruling on the earth, he's going to have a residence, okay? This
right.
kind of thing. And so it would be the temple, okay? Just like God was in the tabernacle and in the temple in the Old Testament. So it turns on that question, it seems to me. And then it's even with the nature of the way God works his plan as it goes, you know, as he's involved in it along the way, with his plan in place, but the way he works it, I don't feel confident to say absolutely there's going to be another temple, but I don't see any reason there couldn't be. That's kind of the where I am at this point.
Just quickly, a lot of people get excited about the rebuilding of the temple, and I can't really understand why. Because in 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 3, we read, let no one in any way deceive you, for it will not come, you know what it is, unless the apostasy comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called god or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, displaying himself as being God. And so the temple that is going to be built that everybody's so excited about will be the place where the false prophet or the Antichrist declares himself to be God, where the false prophet has their ministry. So I'm not really excited about this next temple. You know? And so I'm not sure about this one. I think that there will be one, but it's not my favorite place, you know. And when it comes to Ezekiel 40 through 48, whether or not there will be a millennial temple, I tend to take the scriptures, you know, a little more literally, unless I have reason not to. And I will admit, Ezekiel 40 through 48 is kind of interesting, makes some changes in the actions of the priesthood, and so it's not exactly the same. So I agree with Dick. I don't see why it can't be literal, probably just because I'm a dispensationalist, lead towards it being literal. But do I know for sure? Not particularly, but I know one thing for sure, and that is that the next one that will be built for sure is not going to be someplace I really want to go visit.
Well, thank you so very, very much to each of our presenters. This has been indeed a rich feast intellectually and spiritually, and I trust that it has piqued your interest. We're going to close now in a word of prayer, and immediately thereafter, if you'd like to come and talk with any of our presenters, please feel free to. I think there may still be a few refreshments out in the foyer, but yes, and a book table as well. And we just want to thank every one of you for taking the time out to come and join us this evening, and trust that this has stimulated your thinking and will further encourage you to get deeper into God's word as it speaks about the future. Can we all stand together and be dismissed with closing prayer? Our loving Heavenly Father, how we thank you so much for the privilege of knowing you and for the fact that you have given us your word. This was not something you were obligated to do, but it's just another evidence of your grace to us. Lord, even though you have not told us everything about the future, you have told us some things. We want to thank you so much for each of these dear brothers for leading us this evening as we've considered this important issue, set of issues. Father, I pray that you would continue to use the ministry that has gone forth this evening in our hearts and minds, and that you would stimulate us not only to godly living, but to giving the gospel to both Jews and Gentiles who desperately need to know Jesus Christ. Father, dismiss us now with your blessing. We ask all these things in Christ's precious name. Amen.